to feel alive, want to find something new, something changed, something true that we believe.
Thank you. How's it going, everybody? I'm Ben from Universal Audio, and welcome to Office Hours. It's a beautiful Monday morning here in California. It's not sunny outside, but it's still always beautiful around here. Thanks for tuning in, joining us. Happy to have you guys all here. These are going to be fun shows. We got some Q&A. We'll be able to answer some of you guys' questions in real time, as well as we've kind of rounded up questions from you guys from around the forums and social media. And thank you to everyone that's been contributing to the countdown music. Really love hearing the music that you guys are making and being able to showcase and feature that on the show. So if you are now super jealous and you want to have your music featured in the countdown, it's really easy. Just email us live@uaudio.com. We're monitoring that inbox. We typically need like MP3s or something that we can download. And obviously we want music that's being made in Luna or with UAD products. So tell us a little bit about the song, why you think we should feature it, and then we're going to continue to kind of source music and photos as well from you guys. So keep on posting up photos of your studio setup, of your sessions, and we'll continue to feature those as well on the countdown. I hope you guys are enjoying that. I think it's a really fun way to kind of see what everybody's doing all at the same time. But yeah, it's Monday morning. Thank you guys for being here. I know there's some really important live stream that some fruit company is putting on right now. But you guys are here because we all love Luna and UAD products so much. So we'll find out what's going on in that keynote a little bit later on. But while you guys are here, I brought along a couple friends. We got Matt and Drew. What's up, guys?
Hey, how's it going, Ben? Morning.
Morning, everybody.
Nice. You guys have a good weekend?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
Wondering what the fruit company's going to do.
I know, right? That's
you can always watch the, you know, the sped up version later on, right? You can watch the 5-minute version.
Yeah. Great. Well, guys, so the, you know, we said in the countdown, we kind of teased everybody. We wanted to dive into talking about gain structure with Unison plugins. And we've kind of like, we've touched on this a little bit here or there, but we've actually kind of got, Matt, you've kind of prepared a big deep dive into what to think about and how to approach gain structuring with Unison plugins. And judging by, you know, some of the comments that we've seen across the forums, like there's, you know, a lot of people kind of wondering where the sweet spots are, and then also how the gain staging relates, because, you know, on the front panels of Apollos, or, you know, on the Twins, you've got meters, you've got little LED meters, but everyone's a little, you know, it seems like some people are a little confused about like what those actually mean and like how to follow along with those.
Yeah, absolutely. Got a few different meters, and it's not immediately clear what's being shown on which. So yeah, we're going to go through everything top to bottom. Hopefully have a little bit of something for everybody in this demo here. So
hell yeah, sweet. So yeah, I want to share your screen, and let's dive into it, and everybody in the chat, just feel free to chime in with any questions you guys have along the way, especially if they're about gain staging. We'll touch on them here right away, but just in general, you know, I've seen some good Luna questions, some common questions as well, that we'll loop back around to after we talk about after we nerd out about some gain staging stuff here first.
Right on. Yeah, let's get into it. So kind of just to start off here, a lot of people are, I'm sure, familiar with what gain staging is, but if anybody isn't, so gain staging is basically just how you control the level of a signal as it passes through any audio system. So it could be a plugin, could be a piece of hardware, could be like a mixer, a console, pretty much anything that audio passes through. Gain staging is how you control the level at each stage of that system. So gain obviously refers to the level of the signal. A gain stage is everywhere in that system where you can change the volume of the signal. So we're going to start just by using this 1084, an EVE 1084 preamp as an example. And you're hearing my voice coming through it right now. I just have some moderate settings, so it should be pretty clean. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, for example, on the 1084, there's three different places where you can add level. There's this red preamp knob, there's the level fader, and there's the output knob. So if you're new to using preamps, new to using this particular preamp, it might not be obvious when you would want to boost with one, when you'd want to cut with the other,
yeah,
and so on and so forth. So yeah, I mean, like Ben was mentioning first, let's talk about metering. So when you load up a Unison plugin and the Unison slot of your Apollo, you'll see metering on the front panel of your Apollo interface. You'll see metering in your console channel right here. And you also see metering in Luna if you're using Luna, or if you're using another DAW, you'll see metering on that record arm track. Mm-hmm. So what are each of those meters showing you? Kind of to start, the preamp level, so basically the level that's coming into your Apollo, that's what's showing on the front panel of your Apollo hardware.
Gotcha.
So that's like really the first thing you want to look at. You really never want that to go into the red, because that means you're clipping the converters coming into your Apollo.
So red means you're taking a haircut, right? It's like
exactly. But yeah, red means that you're putting too much signal in. That input can't handle it. It's gonna get cut off. You're gonna end up with a squared off sausage waveform. Mm-hmm. And usually, you know, clipping a converter doesn't sound very good. Clipping the input of something like a Neve can sound pretty pleasing, but clipping an A to D converter usually doesn't sound very pleasing. So
yeah,
and I usually
avoid that at all costs.
I usually tell people, people ask me this a lot online on a day-to-day basis, and I always tell people, if you're recording straight in using the built-in pre, then that front panel LED is kind of useful. But really, once you get into Unison mode, you can kind of forget about that and just sort of use your console meters, and in this case Luna meters, because the gain staging has been handed off to Unison and it's kind of in the background kind of handling it for you. So I think you can really at that point just look at your Luna or console meters and kind of do your thing there, and it kind of adjusts the gain staging as it sees fit.
Yeah, totally. The kind of the console meter, or in this case, you know, Luna meter, they're showing you the same thing. That's kind of like your main meter. Mm-hmm. But there's like one main situation that you would want to still check the hardware meter. So like for the 1084, for example, mm-hmm. when you load it in a Unison slot, this preamp knob right here, it's actually controlling the physical preamp gain on that input.
Mm-hmm.
So what the metering on the front pan of the Apollo will respond to any changes you make with this knob.
That was going to be my question. There's kind of situations. Yeah, it's like, yeah, because the Unison, that's kind of the special thing that Unison plugins do that other, you know, putting them into the recording slots or monitor slots, they won't affect the metering on your front panel. Unison plugins do.
Exactly, yeah, yeah. So if you're just using like a regular insert, the front panel metering is totally disconnected from that. Mm-hmm. When you're using a Unison insert specifically, the front panel metering is tied in.
Nice.
So you can get into a situation where, you know, say I had this red knob just completely cranked, I'd be seeing red on the input of my Apollo, or sorry, on the front panel meter of my Apollo. Mm-hmm. But if I lowered this level fader, if I looked at the console channel, if I looked at the Luna channel, it would look like I wasn't clipping, but I actually would be clipping.
Gotcha.
So yeah, that's kind of why you want to still take a look at that hardware meter just to make sure you're not clipping. And then once you've set the preamp gain, made sure you're not clipping on the front panel, you can kind of forget about that. That's only going to change if you make more adjustments to the first gain stage in the plugin, with the Unison plugin specifically.
That makes sense. So that's the mic gain aspect, and that's kind of like usually it's the heaviest lifting, right? That's where the most gain happens in a signal, is trying to boost a microphone level up to a line level, or, you know, instrument level up to line level, either one of those. That's kind of where the most amount of gain happens. But there's still more gains. There's still more to gain staging inside of any of these plugins, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, just like you said, that first gain stage in pretty much any plugin, but particularly a preamp plugin, that's going to be where you get most of your color from and most of your gain. So if you really wanted to get a lot of saturation, the first gain stage, the preamp gain, that would be what you use for that. So while we're here, let me just kind of demo that. So I've got some pretty moderate settings right now, so you're not hearing any clipping. I'm going to crank up this input gain, and you can hear the louder I go, it kind of adds some saturation. I have a limiter after this, so it's not, you're not getting the full volume of what it would be. But yeah, it definitely changes the sound of it. It's adding harmonics, making it a little bit warm, a little more textured. Mm-hmm. So especially with something like a Neve that has a very colored gain stage, that's where you get that Neve color from, is that first gain stage.
Yeah.
So then that kind of brings up the question of what do you use these second gain stages for then, if this is the main color stage. And then kind of the answer to that is it depends on what you're doing with the plugin, but... in most cases, the other gain stages are kind of used in conjunction with the first gain stage to level things out. So, I mean, if you were really cranked up on the input gain here, I can kind of use this level knob to tailor things back down. So I'm still, now I'm getting more saturation in my vocal, but I've brought it down with the level knob. So it's about the same level as it was before as the clean signal.
So right now your front panel meter, right, is probably going, it's lighting up like a Christmas tree, but your console meter is back down to a reasonable level because you've compensated for the added gain on the input side.
Yeah, that's a great example of what I was just talking about. Yeah, my front panel meter is clipping, it's just fully pegged, but you can see my meter in Luna, which is the same as the meter I'd be seeing in console, it's not even hitting yellow. So yeah, that's case in point why you should check both meters.
Yep.
It
doesn't sound crazy either. Like, it's not, you know, this is kind of, you know, the big advantage of using Unison plugins is this doesn't sound like digital clipping. It doesn't sound like this harsh, just like crispiness. You sound like you're clipping a Neve right now, which has definitely has just more saturation and more character to it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if you were just with no Unison plugin, just cranking up the input, it would sound a lot different. You're actually getting the Neve characteristic saturation when you do it this way, which is awesome. It's just like using a regular hardware pre. You don't really have to worry about converter clipping. It's just you're getting the sound of the hardware.
Yeah.
The other gain stages, usually where you set those are informed by the gain stages before them. So in this one, there's three. There's the preamp, there's the level fader, and there's the output knob. Mm-hmm. If this were like a hardware 1084, this output knob wouldn't be here. So basically this would set the gain coming into the plugin and the fader would set the gain coming out. Or sorry, this would set the gain coming into the hardware and this would set the level going out of the hardware if this was like a hardware 1084.
Gotcha.
The beauty about most of the Unison preamp plugins on the UAD platform is they have this added purely digital output gain stage. And what this lets you do is really maximize the color of the other two gain stages, but you still have this final gain stage that sets the output of the plugin. That you can kind of use to tame things or boost things back up. So for example, if I really wanted to get crazy and just blow everything out. You can hear them pretty distorted right now. If this were like a hardware,
why so mad, bro?
Yeah, <dude. laughs> your whole tone just changed, man.
Just raging out,
man.
Yeah. So yeah, if this were like a hardware 1084, and I wanted to get as much saturation as I possibly could by cranking this all up, mm-hmm. It would be coming out of the preamp really, really loud, and it would probably clip the input of whatever the next piece of gear in the chain is.
Yeah.
If that was a real world situation with the plugin, I can turn the output knob down, so I'm still getting all the distortion as if I were just like slamming this 1084, because I am. But I can bring it back down to actual usable levels. I'm not clipping going into my DAW. I'm not losing anything after the plug-in. I'm not clipping the input to the DAW, essentially.
Yeah.
And Matt, is your Apollo handy? Can you reach over and show the gain staging mode?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Everyone loves the hands-on technique.
Yeah, the hands-on technique. I'm sorry. I wasn't sure if you could reach it or not. So what Matt's doing is he's going over and pressing and holding the preamp knob on his Apollo.
Yeah, exactly. So you can see it highlighted the red knob. So right now, if I move the preamp knob on my Apollo, it's controlling the highlighted knob. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go over here and push it again.
Sorry, I threw Matt a curveball.
No, it jumps over. No problem. Yeah. Now I press it again. The fader is highlighted. Mm-hmm. Now it's adjusting the fader. And I can do the same thing. Press it a third time. Now the output's highlighted. This is really like a tactile way to set your gain staging without having to grab your mouse and drag around. It's much more like setting gain staging on an actual hardware. You're just turning knobs, using your ears, listening for that sound that you want. And when you get it, you stop. You don't have to mess with the mouse. Don't have to mess with your computer. It's all.
Yeah, and on older Unison plugins, you might notice Matt's got the 1084, which is the newest one, which utilizes the new ring feature where it's drawing a circle around the control. In previous older Unison plugins, you might notice that it's a dot on it instead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it's a little bit different depending on the plugin, but there's always some indicator telling you this is what you're controlling right now. Yeah. And so the actual color on the preamp knob changes. So right now there's a green highlighter on the output knob. My preamp knob is green, so it's always giving you a visual indicator of what you're controlling.
Prince in the chat wants to know, is gain stage mode available on Aero? Does Aero do that?
Yes,
it does.
Any Aero, any Apollo Twin, any rack mount Apollo, okay. You can get in the gain staging mode with that.
Awesome, thank you.
Press and hold the preamp knob.
Exactly, it's some of them you press and hold the preamp button, and some of them, was it that you press and hold the knob, or was it always the preamp button?
Yeah, so when you have, I'm pretty sure any of the ones that have a clickable knob, so that's like the first generation Twin, any of the rack mount Apollos, those you press and hold. For like the Aero, where you can't click the knob, it's just has a preamp button that you'd use to switch the preamp. I believe you press and hold that preamp button.
Right.
And same thing with the Twin Mark II.
Yeah, Twin Mark II and X.
Or sorry, yeah, Twin X rather. Yeah, yeah.
Nice. And so, Matt, so there's another gain switch, especially in Unison mode. There's a pad on this plugin. So you have a 0 and a minus 20 pad. When, where, and why would you ever want to use that?
Yeah, so the pad's right here. As I click it, you can hear my voice ducks down. For this particular plugin, it's dropping the input signal by 20 dB. So when you would use that is basically if you have a really, really hot signal coming into the plugin,
mm-hmm.
And you want to avoid saturation. So say that I have like a really, really hot mic signal, and even when I set this preamp knob to 20, I'm still getting saturation.
Yeah.
That would be a prime example of when you'd want to use the pad knob, or sorry, the pad switch. Enabling that will just knock the signal down by 20 dB before it hits this first gain stage. So it'll basically allow you to use a wider range of settings on this gain stage or on this first gain stage without clipping. So just reduces your signal
then,
before that first gain
stage. Yeah, and consequently you shouldn't have the pad on and then bring the gain beyond the value of the pad, right? That wouldn't make sense in other words, having the gain at 40 and having the pad in is the same as having the gain at 20.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah, only if you have.
Yeah, you can get core sniffery here, though, right? Like, you could engage the pad and say you wanted to use the dual gain stages, so you wanted to use the 55 and above on there. Like, in theory, you could use the pad to kind of limit your level coming in and access that different, that extra gain amplifier. But yeah, it's essentially, right, like, when do you use a pad? You use it when you're recording drums. It's I'm trying to think of a time I've used a pad and it hasn't been drum. Maybe like a super, like a really loud synthesizer that's just got a crazy amount of output volume. But right. like...
Yeah, maybe a Fender twin reverb just cranked up or something like that. Mm-hmm. But yeah. It's usually something with really sharp transients like drums.
Yeah, exactly. It's something coming in hot and heavy. And the great thing though is that pad, that's not an emulation of a pad, right? That's a hardware that's actually a pad on the interface that's being engaged, correct?
Yeah, exactly. It's all happening actually before the plugin. Mm-hmm. So there's a pad on the Apollo interface. If you have no Unison plugin loaded, you can enable the pad. This is basically tapping into that circuit. So it's all happening pre Neve 1084.
And you can actually hear the relay switching. That you hear that hardware clicking over inside the Apollo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And right above the pad, you'll see this low and high mic Z switch. That's another, not really a gain stage, but it does change gain staging very subtly. Mm-hmm. It's basically changing the impedance of the mic input. So a lower impedance, you're going to get a little bit louder signal. Higher impedance, you get a little bit lower signal. But it also just has an effect on the tone. Usually lower impedance, you have a little bit more bass frequencies going on. That's another, usually back when the Neve 1084 was made, mics have a particular output impedance. You want to kind of match your preamp to the output impedance of your mic. But in UAD world where you don't necessarily have to do that, you can kind of use this as just another creative tool. You know, it can change the sound of each gain stage, can change the sound of just.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Plugin as a whole.
Yeah, I don't remember what number it was, but it was somewhere in that first 10 that Tom and I did where he had me talk. I was talking into the microphones. It was somewhere in that first 10 where we actually did an audio demo of this, the mm-hmm. difference in that impedance. So if anybody wants to hear that, somewhere in that first 10 episodes, I think it was.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Nice. Yeah, and it's a cool, we're talking about some pretty, well, I love Will's term for this, the cork sniffery, getting into like the real details and the real fine nuances that are available tonally. That's the interesting thing about stuff like the 1084 or the Helios or even the SSL, man, like all of these ones, like putting them into different modes, different paths, different impedance, each one of these imparts just a touch of difference to the sound. And the more that you kind of experience it for yourself, the more you tend to understand, like, oh, if I want a little bit thicker of a low end, then I'm going to switch the impedance here. Because we're talking a couple of percentage difference, right? Like it's 1-2%, like real fine, fine wine type things. Whereas like the gain staging, the big red knob, turn it super up. Yeah, you're going to get nice crunchy new saturation. Sometimes it can be a lot of fun. You can be really loving it in the moment, but then it's really easy to kind of overdo it sometimes. So
using the preamp gain is like painting with a very broad brush. It's not very accurate, but you can get some really like out there results. Whereas the changing the impedance, it's like very subtle, very fine tuning, but it does have an impact on the sound for sure. Mm-hmm.
So now from going from one plugin to another plugin, this is kind of where this is another element of gain staging, right? Because it's essentially the balancing of levels from one device to another, from one gain stage to another gain stage. Can you give people some tips about, kind of chaining together multiple plugins and maintaining proper gain staging?
Yeah, let me move this limiter here. So I'll just load up something that has a meter so we can kind of see what's coming into it. So yeah, that's kind of where the output knob comes in on this one. It really lets you set exactly the level going into the whatever's coming after the 1084.
Yeah.
So it could just be the Luna channel, could be another plugin, whatever have you. In this example, let's see, I'm getting like very, very little gain reduction just whenever I hit like a loud plosive or something like that. But my output gain's already cranked, so let me adjust something here. Check, check, check. Check, check, check. All right. So yeah, let's say I'm getting a lot of compression right now. Too much compression.
Yeah.
So sometimes you can just go into the plugin after it and adjust the input gain settings. Sometimes that's not possible. So obviously one way that I could reduce this would just be reducing the gain on the next plugin. But I can also use the output of the plugin before it, and that'll control how loud the signal that's hitting the input of the second plugin is. So once I lower this, now I'm getting much more moderate compression. Mm-hmm. And if you were using like a, maybe that compressor is not the best example here, but if I was sending a really, really hot signal out of this 1084 to the point where it was like clipping the next plug in the chain,
mm-hmm.
That would really, even if I had the gain all the way cranked down, but I was still clipping, that's really like the perfect place to use this output knob.
Yeah.
Where you can't really adjust anything in the second plugin. It's already as low as it'll go, but you're still getting clipping. Then you can lower the output of the first plugin in the chain, send a decent level signal into it. You get much better results.
Yeah. And this, I remember, when I was a younger engineer, like this stuff confused the crap out of me, like all the time. It was just like, but I mean, you could just turn down the peak reduction instead of turning down the output meter. Like there's always two, three different ways to accomplish the same result. Right. And that's what that's the fun part about this is it's like a balancing act of, yeah, so I could turn the output from my Neve down, or I could come into my LA2A and change the peak reduction so it compresses less. Either way, I'm getting to the same end result, but there's a different sound associated with it.
Yeah, and I think one thing I think you always want to aim for is unity gain. Like, so one of the things you can tell whether you've got things right, let's say you've got a Unison plugin and you have maybe two other things in the inserts. My rule of thumb is always that you should be able to bypass any one of them and not have a radical level change. In other words, input should equal output. And so if you're going through a compressor to compress or for coloration, then you should be able to bypass that compressor and not have a huge, of course you'll have less dynamic range, but not some huge disparity. So if you're having that, then that's probably a sign that you have some gain staging issues to deal with.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. If I swapped out this 1084 for something else, then all of a sudden I have to readjust all my settings on the LA2A because it was gain stage specifically for the way I had the 1084 set up.
Right.
Whereas if I just gain stage the 1084, so it's outputting a pretty nominal level, I could swap it out for whatever and it would be compressing in the same way.
Yeah. Totally. And Drew, yeah, you totally nailed it, man. Like that's kind of the goal most of the time, unless you want to be very intentional about adding gain in. Sometimes I'll use my first insert on it, especially in a mixing scenario. Again, you've got so many opportunities for gain staging, right? You've got clip gain, you've got your first insert, you've got your fader, you have all these different controls that are still, helping you with gain staging. But yeah, being able to audition with and without and not have it just be giving you 10 dB of extra gain. Cause like 10 dB always sounds good. Like an extra loudness. Like you're always going to pick the louder, louder is always going to win. So giving yourself that fair evaluation, whether it's a compressor or EQ, being able to hear the before and after and know that you're not lying to yourself of like, is this just better or is it actually just louder?
Yeah. Yeah. Level matched ABs are, that's like 101, you gotta know how to do that. So speaking of which, Matt, from the chat, Arthur's asking, is there a modifier key that you can press to maintain unity gain as you turn the input knob up on a preamp? And I guess the answer is no, there's not a specific built-in way. It's kind of a thing you got to work, right?
Exactly, yeah. I mean, I guess you'd have to use some kind of reciprocal gain control where it raises the input and lowers the output at the same time. But yeah. You just have to do it manually. Mm-hmm. For a plugin like this,
we have some things like Century, Century Channel Strip has auto makeup gain on its compression, doesn't it, Ben? I think it does, right?
Yep, it's got a one knob compressor. The Studer and Oxide extensions have got the one knob. Century.
Yeah.
So like, there's a few places where we have that, but a lot of the Unison, especially the Unison Channel Strips, their goal is to faithfully model the original thing, and the original thing was just gain up or gain down, and then you're kind of having to do that. Manually between the two.
Yeah, and kind of back to what Drew was saying, it might seem tempting to, if you have like a low signal coming out of your plugin like this, for example,
mm-hmm.
To head over to like your track fader and just crank that up so it's giving you a louder signal, but just like Ben and Drew were saying, it'd be much better to use the output of the plugin that's actually causing those gain changes to level it out instead of boosting up your channel fader, causing uneven gain changes.
And Matt, how often are you, like, that's kind of unusual to have that, the output knob, the digital output all the way up. How, is that something you're doing? Like, I don't find myself adjusting, ever having to have that all the way up. Is that just the way you happen to have this demo set up? Is that?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. I just wanted to keep things as clean as possible on the front end of the 1084. So I'm,
right.
I have pretty moderate settings on the first two gain stages, and I'm making up with it at this output.
Yeah, cool. I'm just going to make sure people don't think that that's like kind of the norm for the for that final stage to be all the way up, you know?
Yeah, but
and this mic has a little bit lower output than most too, so that's another reason I have to boost a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. But that's great, Matt. Like, it's an intentional choice, right? Like, you're using this Neve, which can, you know, as we heard, it can do super saturation, but if you want to be really clean, that's a great way of, like, that final gain stage, it's the digital gain stage, is completely clean. So, boom, you've got 12 dB of gain from there. Fader at zero, and that's, you know, the fader is also another cleanish gain, and then the red knob is where all the color kind of comes in. So you're balancing between these three to achieve a tone that you were looking for. And that's kind of the important part for people to take away, is like, it's, you know, go figure out what sound you're looking for, and then there's multiple different ways to achieve it. It's fun. It's like art, right? There's no hard and fast rules. There's just kind of some guidelines, and then you got to use your ears.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's the beauty of these, using these in plug-in form. You can really just crank knobs, see how things sound. You don't have to worry about hurting anything. You don't have to worry about blowing out the next, you know, device in the chain or whatever. You really have the freedom to experiment.
Just be careful if your musicians got the headphones on, right?
Precisely, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and so there's, you know, one of the things that was added to console a little while ago, and that's in Luna, is the faders can go above zero. So, you know, if you guys have been part of the UAD world for a while, you remember the faders in console used to just go up to zero, and that was it. So having them go up to plus 12, that can actually be, that's another opportunity to gain stage, specifically for like when you're in a tracking mode, or you want to record something, but keep your, if you find yourself kind of struggling with this gain staging thing in general, like if you feel like you're kind of always clipping things or never quite getting it right, being able to use that fader to just give yourself an extra 6 or 10 dB of headroom, so you can hear yourself well over the music, but you're not having to drive the input stage quite as hard. That can be a good shortcut.
Yeah, that was a huge part about that plus 12. You know, when that came in, a lot of people are overdubbing on top of mixes coming out of third-party DAWs that are pretty hot and have limiters on them already, and they're having trouble getting that live signal to get up above that limited hot mix coming out. So that was really a welcome change when that plus 12 came in. Sorry, Matt, go ahead.
Yeah. No, I was just going to say, and that brings up kind of another situation you can get into, where, like, say you're recording, you're looking at your console meter, it's pretty in a good place, mm-hmm. and then you're recording into your DAW and you're seeing like a much lower signal. If you're, say you have like the output of the Neve 1084 isn't as loud as I want it, and I went in here and I cranked up this fader all the way to plus 12 to make it a little bit louder. Now what I'm hearing in the monitoring path, so my headphones, will be louder, but what gets recorded in the DAW is pre-fader, so these fader changes here aren't actually adjusting the level that gets recorded in the DAW.
Yeah.
So if you're getting to a situation where what you're hearing sounds a lot louder than what actually, or sorry, what you're hearing and what you're seeing in the console meters is a lot louder than what actually gets printed in the DAW, check that fader, because you may be, you know, compensating for the monitoring level using the fader, but it's not compensating for the DAW record level as well.
Yeah. And that's the old concept going back and forth between two windows, right? Of like, you're balancing between these two different things. You kind of get your input stage, but then you have to make sure what's getting tracked down to tape is actually the level that you want.
Yeah. And another, you know, way you can kind of get in that situation is, say I had a bunch of plugins loaded here that were changing the gain, mm-hmm. but I had the input set to UAD monitor, not UAD record. So basically whatever's passing through here, I'll hear in the monitoring path, but it won't actually get printed to the DAW.
Mm-hmm.
And again, this is much less of a problem in Luna since it's so tightly integrated with console, but maybe if you're using another DAW. If you do have UAD Mon turned on this channel, you will see some differences in gain between the console channel and what you're hearing in the monitoring path and what gets printed in the DAW. So if you are having that problem, another thing to check.
Nice. Awesome. Well, Matt, man, I think this has been super helpful. Anything else about gain staging that you think people should be aware of or kind of keep in mind as they're going about recording?
Yeah, there's one other kind of tweaky thing that I thought of just a second ago, which is another reason you'd want to use this level knob. Mm-hmm. So again, the preamp knob is the first preamp in the gain stage. If you're following kind of the signal flow of the plugin, then it goes into the EQ, comes out of the EQ, goes into the level fader. So I mentioned you can use the level fader, you know, if you have really high input gain settings to kind of even it out. But another reason you might want to use the level knob, or sorry, the level fader rather, is you have like really extreme EQ boosts. So say I'm boosting by like the maximum amount, that's going to add gain at that frequency. So I can basically create a situation where I'm not clipping the input gain, but I'm boosting really crazily with the EQ and I'm clipping the output stage. So that'd be another reason to pull down this fader, especially if you're doing like really, really extreme EQ boost. Because say I'm going for like a really clean signal here. I have this lower red knob setting. It's not giving me any saturation. I can kind of create saturation after the fact by doing crazy EQ boost. So I can use the level knob to keep it clean while still using the EQ.
Nice.
But yeah, other than that, I think that that pretty much covers it. So.
Hell yeah. Well, it's cool to, and you know, this is definitely like we showed all these examples here with the 1084 today, but this applies to like the 610, to the API Vision, to the SSL E-channel, the Helios, V76. Like, there's so many really great Unison plugins, and they all kind of have their own character to them, which is really. It's the reason why we've chosen to do so many of these. It's like each one of these offers such a different tonal character and kind of options as you're gain staging things around. Yeah, brought up the 610 here. Talk about a simpler, way even simpler kind of gain stage, right?
Yeah, yeah. But just to kind of relate the concepts that we just talked about, the 1084 to the 610, it's really the same thing. You got three gain stages. You got your input gain stage. You got your level. In this case, it's a knob, not a fader, and then you have your output stage. So it's pretty much the same exact thing as the 1084. You'd set it up in the same way. So if you kind of understand those key concepts, you can pretty much pull up any preamp plugin, and it's going to be the same process to get the most out of the plugin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it can be really fun to kind of explore, jumping from one to another, going from one preamp to another, and really, you know, again, just tuning your ears into like listening for what these differences are and what each one offers. So that when you're on a session and you know you got a vocalist there in the room with you, you can kind of reach back into your experiences and know like, oh, I remember, you know, when I recorded a vocalist like this, like for this type of song, like the 610 had the perfect like saturation color to it. Or you know, you're about to do some rock stuff, you know, like some rock drums, you're like, oh, I really want the API kind of color to this. You start learning those colors and the different tools in your tool belt, and then pulling out the right one and being able to confidently set it up, knowing that you're getting good levels, but you're also not just, you know, it's not just about getting good levels into your DAW anymore. It's about getting great sounds in there at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah. And especially with a preamp, you can add saturation in a pretty subtle way that it like impacts the sound in a pretty big way. So yeah, there's a lot of, lot to be said for like understanding how to gain stage your plugins. It really lets you get the most out of your vocalist performance, gets the most out of whatever mic you're using. Yeah, it's really all around lets you get the most out of your gear.
Yeah, as Matt said the word subtle, which I think was, I want to, you know, expand upon, because one thing I've always encouraged people online is to don't be afraid to commit, you know, like please. It's like, that's one of the things that's getting lost in, you know, engineering. It's like people are afraid to commit. It feels like the right thing to do to defer all of the decisions until later, but you know, it's often not a good idea. I mean, Matt said subtle, like preamps are pretty subtle. If you've gone through the Unison preamps and you're thinking, wow, there's not that much difference between these, first of all, it depends on how much you've driven it, but also it's subtlety. You know, the subtlety stacks on subtlety stacks on subtlety stacks on subtlety, and all of a sudden something that used to be subtle is pretty big. So I think like minimum commit the Unison preamps. It takes a lot of the, you know, and then even a little bit of, you know, a little high pass filtering and or a touch of compression. Like, you know, not only does it get you, makes mixing easier, you do less during mixing, but this is something a lot of people don't realize. The better it sounds in the moment, the better the performance the artist gives. You know, if you take a SM7 and slap it into a stock preamp and don't do anything to it and feed that to an artist, they're not going to give you their best performance, you know, because you haven't zhuzhed it up for them, you know? So don't be afraid to commit.
I mean, it's like, yeah. Matt, it's like trying to, right, say you're about to record some rock guitars and it's going to be this big distorted chorus part, but you're like, you know what, let's record this completely clean, just DI, and then I'm going to put the sound on it afterwards. Like, you're going to play, you're not going to play with the same, you're going to play really, especially if you're trying to do rock, right? Like, without distortion on it in the moment, you don't know how to react. It's the same thing for vocalists, for drummers, for bassists, for anyone.
Yeah.
Having as much of a complete thought sonically as possible gives you such a head start, and it gives what you hear back in the headphones just adding that inspiration, adding that energy to it, musicians and artists, they'll always reflect that back, and it comes across in the performances.
Don on Facebook's asking about a cleanest, fattest Unison preamp for acoustic. I'd say 88RS. Neve 88RS is like a great combination of clean and fat. I don't know if you have a choice for that, Ben.
Yeah, I would say the 88RS is a great one. Dude, that new Avalon 737.
Oh yeah, yeah.
You want to talk about clean, but still has character, has fat to it, and then it's such a versatile one because it's got a built-in compressor, built-in EQ, and the frequencies that are available, especially in that EQ, mate. Like, I find myself pulling that one out all the time for guitars, basses, vocals.
So try those two, Don.
Oh, and also the other one that some people sleep on is the V76. It's one of the ones that has the least amount of like extra tone controls and stuff to it, but it is one of the sweetest sounding tube preamps I've ever heard.
Yeah,
yeah, that's a great one. Nice. Just kind of on the topic of subtlety. Another thing to be aware of too is like very subtle actions in the plugin can have pretty big results as well. So, I mean, just like as simple as one click up on the gain stage, on the first gain stage, that can have a pretty big impact on like the amount of saturation that you're experiencing, or that you're hearing rather. So definitely like, don't be afraid to, even if like you set at one level, the signal looks like it's a good level, bump it up a few steps, bump it down a few steps, see how it changes the signal, you know, experiment with a little bit. Cause you might be surprised how just tiny changes have pretty big impact on the way things sound.
Oh yeah, you're totally right, and it was one of the big things I remember from my college days. One of our professors, for every recording date that we would be going on for a class or whatever, he would say, "Try it one way, try it another way, try it a third way, and then try your first way again." Like, because you never want to just go with exactly the first one. It literally takes seconds to try something different, right? Like, try a slightly different gain stage or move the mic an inch, like. Change something, just see if you can push it one thing further. And a lot of times, like, this is what a lot of professional engineers do, is like, that's kind of the advantage they have, that, you know, it's not just the experience, but the kind of the willingness to experiment with something, take the extra 30 seconds or a minute that it takes to try something to see if they can make it that much better, like that couple of percentage points better, that adds up across, especially across, you know, a big session or a larger mix.
Yeah, and with something like this where there's so many different controls, I think it's really easy just to arbitrarily, you know, pick a way to set it and then do that every single time, which is a really like dangerous trap to get into. I mean, that's why all these plugins have so many different controls, because you can get so many different tones out of them. So, you know, make sure you use that.
Matt, there's a good comment here from Facebook. Can you show saturating the 610B? Do you mind swapping out your 1084 for a 610 and just driving it like crazy to see what we can get out of it?
Yeah, let's do it. I'm going to mute my channel for a second so I don't blow you guys out.
And by the way, while Matt's switching that over, one thing I would encourage people to don't forget, we're talking about this in the context of a mic signal, but all of this that we're saying is something you can do on playback tracks. So you can, you know, you put a 610B or 610A across the top of every channel strip and bypass them all on and off at the same time, you'd be amazed at like, sort of, it's kind of like the Studer, you know, a lot of people do that with the Studer plugins, but you can do the same thing with these guys as well. So that's something to definitely try that.
All right, check.
Nice.
You can hear me right?
Yeah, we got you back. A little bit lower. By default,
right? A little bit lower. Yeah, and the 610B... crank this up a little bit. 610B is a little bit like the gain structure of it is a little bit different than the 1084. And the main way is that like the preamp gain and the level, as in terms of how much color and how much gain they can add, they're kind of swapped in the 610B. So you remember in the 1084, the red knob, it's capable of adding a ton of gain. It's where all the color comes from. The 610, you can see at max, it adds 10 dB of gain. So this is maxed out on the preamp of the 610B. You can hear it's adding a little bit of harmonic saturation, adds a little bit of texture in my voice, but it's not crazy blown out like the 1084 was when it was cranked. So then to kind of compensate for that, the 610B has this level knob, which has a ton of gain. Let me crank this up. So yeah, it has a lot more gain than the preamp knob does, and it's a tube output stage, so it still has a lot of color. But again, you know, this is the 610B totally cranked with the same exact mic. It's much more subtle. It's not as blown out as the 1084 was, but it's still giving you a lot of good tube saturation, a lot of good color.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, imagine coming into this with like electric bass. Like that's where you really hear the tubes working. And it's like come in there with like a healthy level out of a bass, and you'll just get all sorts of boom, boom, like big fat distortion.
Yeah, and let me see if I can switch things around and show you what this thing sounds like when you really overdrive it. Give me 1 second here.
Ah, I see what you're doing. So pulling it out of the Unison slot.
Check. Yeah. All right.
Explain to people what you just did there.
So yeah, basically I'm adding, still a little clipping. I'm adding another gain stage before the 610. So basically I'm moving the 610 out of the Unison preamp slot, which frees up this preamp gain. So now I can boost with the preamp on the Apollo before going into the 610.
Gotcha.
Which lets me get a little bit more gain before I hit the 610. Mm-hmm. So let's crank this up.
There you go. All right, your train.
That's what the 610 sounds like.
Your train is arriving in 6 minutes.
Yeah, so here, let me tame that.
Actually, that's one of the cool things about Unison, especially when you with the amp sims. The amp sims take that, right? Like you take what Matt just did there when you are not using an amp sim in Unison, you're now guessing on that gain stage. So one of the beauties of Unison with the amp sims is that they take the guesswork out of what Matt just did. So what he's showing you as a positive is actually, it's when you're using the amp sims, it's cool that you don't have to think about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, now, this isn't as much of a real-world demo. I just wanted to show you kind of the range of the 610 can be fairly subtle, fairly clean, but if you hit it with a hard signal, it can be pretty crazy.
Oh, yeah. Well, and it's so true because, and again, this goes back to the warts and all thing. Of like, the 610, this was the era before the 1073s. You know, this was some of the first mic preamps being made. They weren't optimizing for a crap load of gain. Like the overall levels for everything was a lot lower back in those days. So the Unison version of the plugin stays super true to that. But man, you just showed us a really cool workaround. I hadn't actually thought about doing it that way before. Pulling it out of the Unison slot, so you have you've got full 70 dB of Apollo clean gain. Now driving that into the 610 and allow you got so much more color out of it instantly.
Yeah, that's a great drive pedal. You can use that's a good little overdrive pedal. Like it's a great overdrive pedal.
Yeah, I think I've probably used the 610B as a distortion box more than I'm using it as an actual preamp. It sounds awesome when it breaks up.
Oh yeah, that's huge. Hell yeah, awesome. And then everyone's just kind of wondering about the overall final output. So how do you make sure that if you're kind of having fun inside a console, inside a Luna, up in the input stage, how do you always make sure that what you're going to, when you press record, that the signal that you record, how do you make sure that that's always in a good spot?
Yeah, I think, let me get rid of this. All right, check. I think it depends on where you're using the plugin, how you're using the plugin.
Mm-hmm.
But using the either Luna channel or console channel, depending on if you're using another DAW, if you're using Luna, is probably the best way, because that's basically showing you in most cases, showing you the final signal as it will be printed in the DAW.
Mm-hmm.
Again, you got to keep in mind the things like UAD record versus UAD mon, like I was talking about before.
Yeah.
You have that in UAD mon, it will give you differences in level. Those things aside, using this console channel or the Luna channel, depending on how you're recording, I think that's the best way. And then using the final gain stage using the first two gain stages in whatever preamp you're using to kind of set the tone, set the color, and then using the final gain stage in the plugin to kind of set the level in the meter. Just making sure, general rule of thumb is you want to get the loudest signal possible without clipping. So if you're peaking in the yellow but not going in the red, that's perfect. Mm-hmm. Some cases you might want to record a little bit lower if you it's a little bit more dynamic performance, it gets louder in parts. This is if the 610B is the last plugin in the chain. If I had other plugins in the chain coming after the 610B, then I would want to use the gain stages in whatever the last plugin in the chain is to set the final output level. Nice. And everywhere in between to make sure that things are hitting each other at good levels.
One thing you can do that if you're not sure is like if every mix you ever do, you feel like all of your faders are way down below zero in order to keep the stereo bus from clipping, that's probably a sign you're tracking too hot, you know? Yep. Like, so the idea is you want to track individual elements at a level that maintains the headroom, that maintains headroom for mix processing. And so that the goal should be that all your faders are around the sweet spot of the taper, which is in that, you know, whatever, -6 to +3-ish in that range. That's the comfortable spot for me probably. But and then that when they all get summed together, they're not crushing the stereo bus. So if you find that you're having to pull all your faders down, then you're probably tracking too hot. If you find that you're having to gain stuff up and push faders up, you're probably tracking too soft, you know, if you had to give it some practice, you know.
Yeah. Well, and one other really important parameter I'd love you to show them, Matt, is pre-fader versus post-fader metering. Because this can this affects what you perceive as going down to tape, right?
Yeah, no, that's a great point. I was thinking about that. So what you see in this meter, whether it be Luna or console, it can be pre-fader or post-fader, which has a pretty big impact on what you're seeing in the meter.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're using, I'll show you where it is in both places, but start in. So in console, you go to console settings, then on the display tab, you set the metering to pre-fader or post-fader. So right now I have it set to post fader, which means if I were to come in here and crank this level down,
you can see the meter goes with it.
The metering drops down with it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just to show you the opposite of that, if I have it set to pre fader, no matter what I do here, the metering doesn't change.
Gotcha. Yep.
So it's always showing me the output of the last plugin in the chain. It's not showing me any gain changes made with this fader.
Yep.
So that's another thing to take into account when if you're using this fader to judge what your final record level is going to be, make sure you know if it's in pre-fader or post-fader and react accordingly, you know.
Nice. And then
just to show how you Luna. Get there in Luna. Yeah. So in Luna, click the UA Diamond icon on the settings panel. You'll notice this looks pretty much exactly like...
looks so familiar. I just feel like I just saw this.
The console panel we're just at. And I believe options, display, it's right here, pre-fader, post-fader.
Nice.
So, same deal. If you have it set to pre-fader and you make any adjustments with the actual Luna channel, you know, this fader right here, the metering won't reflect it. So, just be aware of what you have it set in and, keep track of it.
Nice. Awesome. Matt, dude, this was such a good deep dive into gain staging. Like, I've even learned a couple of things. You hit me with a couple of tricks here, especially that, you know, pulling it out of the Unison. You know, you're always like, we're constantly, especially here at UA, we're always thinking like, get into Unison because we all love the sound of that. But you're right, for that 610, like, that's a cool trick to pull it out and use it more of a distortion box rather than as the preamp. And that's also to say you could load up two 610s. I just thought of that. Like, you could leave one up there doing your first preamp stage and you could roll it into another one, or you could do a 1084 into a 680. The options are limitless. You can do...
And it's that trick. Remember the trick of putting the tube screamer in the mm-hmm. Unison slot bypassed to get the impedance matching and then go into something else. You know, we did that before too. Mm-hmm. The other thing I'd mention is, I know we haven't touched on Luna too much, but like when it comes to gain staging is like the tape extension, Studer and Oxide really help you. They literally will teach you gain staging. You know, like if you think back to Tom's demo of all the tape and how different instruments react differently, if you really listen to that tape extension and see how, you know, when you record a vocal, check out how hard it's hitting the tape extension upon playback and then adjust your gain accordingly. Or same with guitar or basses. And like, you'll mm-hmm. actually start to learn how hot should I be recording something that's low frequency focused based on how it hits the Studer at the default range. And once you start paying attention to them, like instead of having to hit the saturate knob so much, you're now just recording and tracking at the appropriate level to hit the Studer where you want it to be. So it's almost like Luna can help you teach you gain staging in a matter of speaking by using that tape extension.
Oh, totally.
Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, great. Yeah, dude, Matt, this was super helpful. And for everybody watching, there'll be a replay of this, so you'll be able to come back in and digest this again if anything went too fast or if you joined us midway through the show. And we got an update. Danielle gave us the update from the fruit company that nothing too incredible yet, she says. So I think everybody's we've all increased our overall knowledge of audio and the background. They were announcing just nothing too fancy yet. But yeah, there was a couple other, you know, just want to touch on a few questions that kind of came up here through the chat as we were going through. So Prince had a question here of like, I have a, you know, sometimes with these preamps and plugins, they'll sound great in the moment, but then there's lots of noise, or they'll have, you know, or too much color or too much noise happening. What would cause noise issues in terms of gain staging?
That's a good question.
Well, one thing I would say is, I was going to say, Matt, while you're thinking of your answer, Matt, I'll just say that one thing I think some people, if we can define noise, you know, like I think a lot of people don't understand, it brings up room tone and it brings up first reflection points, and it can actually, you know, running some of these preamps kind of hot or can actually help show any acoustic anomalies you might have in your room, you know, like, so what you're describing as noise might actually be room tone, ambient noise, you know, look for computer fans and spinning hard drives in your HVAC systems and all that stuff. So maybe some of this noise stuff is not so much electronic noise, but ambient noise too. So, but Matt, I don't know if you want to add to that.
Yeah. I think that's great. Kind of, one thing I could think that could cause that would be, just the differences of monitoring your signal in like a recording workflow versus a mixing workflow. You know, if you're just monitoring the output of the preamp, with no compression or anything like that, and then you go to mix the same recording and you add compression, you're going to be bringing up the noise floor. So it's like, it could sound fine when you're recording it, but then when you go to mix it, you're kind of revealing things that were in the audio file, but maybe not as apparent when you were first recording. But yeah, I mean, pretty much any time you add a lot of gain with a preamp plugin on the front end, you are kind of raising the noise floor, whatever self noise the mic has, any interference that you're picking up. And it may not be obvious until you go and compress that signal later and bring that noise floor up even further. You know?
Yeah. That's for me, that's another, it's another argument to commit some, you know, at least, even if you're not going to commit it, at least audition it. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. You got a good vocal tone and you're thinking, you know, do I like this vocal tone? Let me spank it a little bit and see how it reacts, you know, see how it responds. And that's, you might bring up some weird room tone and stuff.
Well, and that's the thing. This is the balance that we're always kind of optimizing for with gain staging is, like, you know, the more gain you're adding, you're bringing that noise floor up. So, you know, this is where it's really important to, you know, have good quality cables, where your cables are physically. Like, you know, I've got a couple of cables here in my room that kind of run along the floor right next to some power. So every once in a while, like, I've had just even moving them a couple of inches or kind of moving them perpendicular would get rid of the noise. So you do want to be aware that, you know, the causes of noise are not always just the preamp. Sometimes it's a really low volume microphone that needs a ton of gain. These are all considerations you have to make. So there's a lot of different approaches to this, and this is why, you know, you'll see people with, like, you know, the most popular SM7 accessory nowadays is like the Cloud Lifter or the DB Booster. You know, something that, like, right, gives it so that way when it's hitting the preamps, it's already, you know, bumped up in level 10 or 20 dB. And that's to help optimize for noise, because by putting that gain a little further up in the stage, it can help reduce the noise. But yeah, this is what you're optimizing for. If you want really crunchy stuff, you know, if you want to really crunch out the 1084, but you want to, you know, record it at a proper level, you're going to be blowing out your first gain stage, increasing the noise, and then just dropping everything down. And if you've been clipping, then yeah, you've changed that relationship. You've made the noise closer to your ceiling, so it's going to be more obvious. And this is why noise gates were invented. This is why the SSL channel, the API channel, like these, that's why they have an expander gate built into them, was to allow you to, you know, go nuts, you know, add more gain, but then also control room noise or electrical noise to make it a little bit less obvious. And then, you know, nowadays we've got so many great modern tools like Isotope, Isotope RX, and Denoiser. Like, there's tons of great denoising tools these days. So, you know, there's plenty of solutions to get back out of it. If it's kind of getting in the way of the music, that's when you really want to, like, look for solutions. But I think this is kind of what you're getting at there, Drew, is like, go back and listen to your favorite records. There's noise all over it. There's hum. Yeah. There's hiss. There's tape hiss. They were constantly battling noise, back in the day. And, you know, doing battle with it, sometimes it's, you know, the harder you fight it, the more obvious it becomes. And sometimes just kind of like letting it be, like, yeah, dude, it's an analog recording. Yeah, there's hum. Like, that's just, that's is what it is. It makes it feel more real and a little bit more raw in a sense. Which can be the vibe for a record, or it can be totally breaking the vibe, and then, you know, that's when you break out the RX and spend an hour or two really getting in there and trying to polish it up.
Yeah, well, it's funny. A lot of people think that, like, people listen to old records and they're like, man, it was so fat, it was so round, and like, and it had so much saturation, had this character, and had all these harmonics. And meantime, you talk to the engineer that did it, and they were saying, I was trying to make it as clean as possible.
Yeah.
I was trying to make it as clean as possible, and it ended up like this. So it's like the tools influence the outcome, you know?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Nice. Well, guys, man, this is super fun. I know we, you know, we had on the agenda to try to get into some troubleshooting steps, but I think we'd probably be best to save those for our next episode, since we got to dive super deep on the gain structure and answer a bunch of questions kind of related around this. The good thing is that we're gonna be back next week. We're gonna be back. We actually, you know, fingers crossed, we'll have a fun announcement for next Monday's episode.
Oh, teaser. Yeah.
I know. So. Thank you, Matt. Thank you so much, man. That was a great demo. It was really helpful information. And
awesome.
Yeah, just really good to kind of cover this and cover it nice and exhaustively like this, especially around how to use Unison and how to make sure that what people are, the signals and the levels and tones that people are recording show up really well. So yeah, great job, Matt. Really cool. Nice to hear it, right? It's one thing to just sit here and talk about gain, but to actually hear the effect it's having in the moment makes all the difference.
Yeah.
And just so everybody
reinforces.
Yeah, that was
going to say, that really reinforces. Don't be afraid to like go in there and try out different preamps, crank up knobs, see what they sound like. Cause we can talk about all this stuff, you know, theoretically, but it doesn't really mean much until you actually hear what it's doing. So
yeah, it was cool to hear it. I was just going to say, like, you know, letting everybody watch and know and everybody in the chat know if they want, you know, if you have topics that you want us to cover on this Monday's show, then, you know, come to the forum, post on social media, whatever, you know, give us your ideas and we'll collect them up and put them into the queue and see what we, you know, can do in the future to answer your questions with the similar sort of deep dive that Matt did here. So.
Yeah, absolutely. And absolutely. And of course, we're always looking for photos and music to feature in our upcoming countdowns. So for photos, just tag us, hashtag Universal Audio. And we've got our social media team. They're constantly scouring and finding us new photos to feature. But for music, hit us up at live@uaudio.com. It's a special email address just for all the UA Live stuff. So if you've got some music that you've been making that you'd like us to feature, shoot us an email with a link and, you know, downloadable MP3. Let us know what you're doing, what you're working on, how UA and hopefully Luna was a part of it. We love kind of featuring new and awesome music that you guys are making out there. And yeah, we'll be back here tomorrow. I've got Fab is coming in at 10 o'clock tomorrow. We're going to be doing a from scratch mix. So starting from just raw vocals and guitar, which I know is a very familiar mixing scenario for a lot of us right now, getting a lot of artists and clients who are sending us these, you know, at home recorded projects. So he's going to share a bunch of tips about how to take a real simple recording done at home and transform it into something that sounds really great. So tune in for that tomorrow. Another Tales from the Switch with Fab at 10 Pacific. And then we'll be back with another Office Hours next Monday. So hope to see you guys all there. Everybody have a fantastic Monday. Thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you guys next time.
Bye, everybody.
See you guys.